This is Ham Radio Now episode, I don't know, the number is going to be down here on the screen pretty well, and...
I guess this is the Phasing Line podcast.
Do you want to do another one of these Phasing Line things?
Phasing Line?
Yeah.
What's that?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, and I think this is episode, we're going to wrap this all into 12, maybe?
Eh, whatever.
Numbers.
We're going to talk digital voice and what is coming up, and you don't operate any digital voice, do you?
I do. D-Star, DMR. Yeah.
You have a DMR?
I do have a DMR. I have a Titerra. Okay.
You didn't bring it.
I didn't bring it.
You're borrowing mine.
Borrowing yours.
All right. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. And just stop by hamradionow.tv. Click Arvin, Starvin Arvin. Oh, by the way, we are at the Dayton Hamvention.
Oh, yeah.
In beautiful downtown, beautiful suburban Xenia, Ohio.
And you have a name, too, right?
What?
You're Gary Pierce.
Oh, and I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
And I'm Marty, KC1CWF.
Fundraising for Phasing Line is?
PhasingLinePodcast.com. Click the donate button. Pick how you want to give us money.
Yep. All right. Our guests are going, what did we sign up for?
Yeah. Look at these idiots begging for money.
Okay. We're going to talk about digital voice, stuff that is coming up that's new. Is this going to be mostly D-Star, or do you guys do anything else?
All of my products right now are D-Star based.
All right. So you are pretty much
the same.
Okay. And you are?
I'm Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC.
And I am John Hays, K7VE.
Okay. So we're going to mostly talk about D-Star. I keep hearing people on the air saying things like, well, D-Star is disappearing, isn't it? Apparently not.
There are so many devices out. And even here at Dayton, several new devices have come out for it. And Kenwood just released their HT for D-Star.
Last year, a year ago.
That's new in D-Star years. D-Star's been around for 15 years now. And we released the DVDongle 10 years ago and the DVAP 7 years ago.
And so it looks like you have a toy with you as well today.
We did announce a new product that will be shipping later this year, which is the DV Air family of products. And we're adding Wi-Fi and Bluetooth and Ethernet to our devices so that you can take it with you.
Okay, so does that operate more like a DVAP? You talk into it with a handy talkie or a dongle? You talk into it with a computer?
Yeah. This is more like a dongle, but it's a wireless dongle. So it's got a battery in it. And you turn it on, and you put it in your pocket, and you pull out your cell phone, and you talk to D-Star. And you connect to reflectors and repeaters.
So there's an app for that?
There will be an app for that. Actually, our hardware is complete. We're working on the software right now.
So how does it connect to your phone? Is that Bluetooth?
It has Bluetooth and Wi-Fi.
Okay.
All right. But there's been a whole lot of other products that have come on the market for D-Star. But you are probably pretty happy that Kenwood chose D-Star.
Absolutely. We've been on Kenwood's case. All of us have been on Kenwood's case for years and years, and they just kind of laughed at us. And then out of the blue, they came out with their HT, and it's been very well received. They're very responsive to firmware updates when people report problems. Very shortly thereafter, they release firmware updates. So they're very committed to the D-Star market.
So maybe Kenwood's dead, except D-Star.
Well...
We mocked Kenwood all day.
I don't expect
yesterday.
Them to go away anytime soon.
Yes.
Yeah. We're just not seeing any new HF stuff from them. Yeah.
So the new handheld, one of the features that came out with it was D-Star on 220. And Robin put together a DVAP to give access to that band. And amongst the projects that I'm doing is the ability to put D-Star on other types of repeaters and from different manufacturers. And last year, I rolled out taking the Yaesu DR1X and adding D-Star to Fusion and Analog on it. And this year, we've worked with Bridgecom Systems, and their 220 repeater now is dual mode analog and D-Star with an add-on from us.
So is that the only product on the commercial market that is both... That is a hybrid for D-Star analog?
Well, both the Yaesu and the Bridgecom, and we actually have used the same with some homebrew and some Kenwood 700 series repeaters. So
none of the ICOM hardware, though, supports...
Well, they have their own.
Right.
Actually, they do have a little device that Jim McClellan showed off, and there was a board made for it.
They had the commercial repeater and they put a board in it. Yes,
yeah, they did. D-Star.
Thanks for the reminder.
Everybody's done it now.
Yeah. So there's life in D-Star yet. When D-Star first came out and they were using the Ambi 2020 vocoder, I talked to the guys at DVSI because some of the complaints about it was, it's going to be horribly expensive to roll your own, and it's proprietary and all that. People call D-Star proprietary, and they're wrong. That's the proprietary component, is the vocoder. And I called him up, and I said, what if a ham wanted to do his own? Will you sell him one? Yeah. How much?
Sell him just the vocoder, you're saying?
Just the vocoder. Yeah. Just the chip, the Ambi 2020 chip, which was their current chip at the time. How much? $20. So all the people that were complaining that D-Star is horribly proprietary, it was just the
$20.
Yeah, $20. And you can roll your own. And I'm sure that you buy them in greater quantities for something cheaper than that.
Well, we've moved to the 3000 series now,
yeah.
And John also has a 3000 series product.
Yes.
And those are a little more expensive, actually, because they do many more protocols. They do the protocols used for DMR and Nexten and APCO 25 Phase 2 and Inmarsat.
The other thing I asked him was, so have you closed your lab? Is this the last product? And he said, no, we're going to keep on making new stuff. D-Star is stuck at the vocoder that was in the 2020. Am I correct at that? You can't make much in the way of changes without becoming incompatible with the installed base.
Correct. However, Robin's experienced this, I'm sure, as we did, and the new Kenwood radio demonstrates this. If you put better audio stages before and after the new Ambi 3000 chips, most people subjectively looking at it, it's better audio. So
the limiting factor is not really the chip or the protocol. And we've got the DVDongle, he's got the Thumb DV, we've got the DV3K dongle. And when you plug it into a computer and use good microphone, good headphones, you get pretty good fidelity out of it.
It's really
the microphone and the speakers and the radio that are limiting.
How new is the 3000 chip?
Three, 4 years.
Yeah.
And Kenwood and their handheld are using better audio stages and digital signal processing to better shape the audio coming in and out of the chip.
Yeah. So I noticed with just my original DV dongle, that D-Star audio could be very good or pretty good, but ICOM apparently limited fidelity drastically. I know in my old 2820, it was terrible. There's no low end. The original IC91 wasn't bad. By the time they got to the 92, once again, they rolled off the low end a lot.
And it's a decision of the manufacturer as to how much money they want to put into that.
And the folks talking on DV dongles coming over the repeaters, if you had a halfway decent speaker, sounded pretty good.
Yeah, I connect to the reflectors all the time just to monitor. And you get two people with dongles or equivalent devices talking to each other, and it's really good quality. And then somebody comes in with an older radio, and it's like, what are they using?
Yep. So the question is, and this is just pure ignorance, what is stopping the radio manufacturers, if you're using the vocoder that'll do DMR and it'll do D-Star and it'll do whatever else it is, what is stopping them from making these digital radios only do D-Star and analog? And what's stopping them from adding DMR besides sales and marketing?
Management.
It's management, and also... one thing a lot of people don't realize is that DMR actually has intellectual property licensing that you need to do. So in addition to the basic engineering and the management guidance, they're going to add a little tax on top of their development costs. And, you know, some people are out there ignoring that. But as far as we've seen, there's been a large lawsuit over that very thing.
Motorola suing Hytera.
Correct.
And I don't know if that's going to get to these guys, you know, TYTs and the...
They're safe in China.
Okay. But
Motorola has long arms. They can prevent them from coming into the country.
So here's something that came up today when we were doing chatting with Carl from RTLSDR. And one of the things he talked about was the notion of decoding D-Star in straight software, sans vocoder, just software alone.
So you can purchase a license from DVSI, and they give you the code to put in your system, and there's no hardware that you have to buy. But it's a very expensive license, and you still pay a per-seat royalty on it. So it's typically out of the range of what a small ham organization can
do. I guess this was pirated software, I'd assume.
We were kind of asking about that.
Yeah,
there is some open-source decoding software.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So I had heard that ICOM was no longer putting the chip in their radios, that they were doing it in software. Can you confirm or deny that?
I don't know for a fact, but I'm pretty sure they're not putting the AMBA chips in.
So they bought the license and...
I believe all the major manufacturers just buy the software license. And they've already got... What DVSI delivers to you is a TI chip that has the algorithm on it that they've blown the fuses so you can't read the algorithm back out of it. But if you have a source license, you can use a different processor to hold that algorithm.
It's just a DSP chip.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. You can put it on whatever you want once you have the code.
Correct.
Right.
So you guys are doing a forum on the future of, is it purely the future of D-Star, or were you getting broader?
We've had multiple events here. There's always a meet and greet on Thursday night, on
you are
Friday.
You're not allowed to thump over here.
I got that. No rugs.
No thump.
On Friday, the forum, and that's both, we had a really good talk from Ed on the history of D-Star.
It was excellent.
It's always good to hear that.
Yeah.
We sat down and went through all of the logs, all the Yahoo groups to find out when things were announced. And it was a blast from the past.
It really was. Together. It was an excellent piece.
And then future products. And then on Friday night at Dayton, there's always a big get-together at Drury Inn, where even more manufacturers that didn't get to talk in the forum come up and talk about their products.
Yeah. So, I recorded the one in 2008 at the Drury Inn. I think that was the second one that Jim McClellan gave. And that's online if anybody wants to go see it. You see all the D-Star stars from
HamRadioNow.tv.
Yeah, it's actually not on
ARVN.
It's an old ARVN show, but it's still there.
So here's my question. Every time I talk to a ham about digital modes, the question comes up. Which one is it? Do I buy a D-Star radio? Do I buy a DMR radio? Do I buy a Fusion radio? I'd be intrigued to hear both of your answers.
You buy a Chevy. You buy a Ford.
Exactly.
You buy an Audi. Each protocol has its strengths and weaknesses. Both D-Star and Fusion were designed for ham radio. So they have ham radio call signs and ham radio data, and they're really tailored towards ham radio.
Right.
The other protocols are typically commercial protocols that have been brought in and been used by hams for their repeaters.
Yeah. I call them octagonal pegs going into round holes. They're not totally square, but they're not.
Right.
You have to shave off some corners.
That's your P25 and your DMR and that sort of thing.
And a lot of it's your application, too. You have to understand P25 and DMR were designed for centrally managed fleets. You send your radio into the shop. They give you what they call a code plug that has the channels that you're going to use, and they hand you back the radio, and they say, go to channel 1, go to channel 2, go to channel 3.
Yeah.
It's not how amateur radio traditionally operates, where we have independent operators setting up their own radios with their own operating parameters and operating.
Frequency agile.
Stay up close there, John.
Get up
on that
microphone. Yeah.
I got to eat the mic.
Yeah. Yep. Tastes real good.
Tasty. Toffee tasty.
And your voice with that high mic and a little bit of presence is, it's awesome.
Yeah. That's kind of the difference between protocols that were designed by hams for hams versus ones that were really designed for land mobile or public safety. your use case. And I can see why a group that operates in that quasi fleet mode, an emergency response team or something like that, where they've gotten a bunch of people licensed that got licensed purely to do that thing. They're not, you know, they want to have a radio and mash and mumble and just switch the channel and mumble again.
Right.
Push pontificate.
Right. I would like to address with you, though, the DVSI question.
Yeah.
Because everyone talks about proprietary. If you pick up any one of your modern radios, every piece of technology in it has a patent on it. And DVSI's chips are just another component in the radio.
Yeah, like I made that point a few times. Yeah. You know, there's plenty of ASICs in there that you're not going to build your own ICOM or Kenwood or Yaesu radio.
The display, the keyboard, the microprocessor that's coordinating everything, they're all proprietary. Yeah.
But then there is Codec 2.
Yes.
Address the concept of Codec 2 from your perspective a little bit.
Well, Codec 2 was done by a very brilliant individual.
What is Codec 2? I'm going to take a step back.
It's an open source codec. So, you know, back when D-Star was born or conceived of, the only real game in town was the DVSI. And they had by far and still have, by some margin, the best audio quality for the bandwidth that you're using. Codec 2 has made major strides, and you know, 20 years later now, we have a viable open source codec that could be used.
Yeah, there was an open source codec back when they started called Speaks.
Right.
But it wasn't designed for real low bitrate.
Exactly.
Very carefully tailored speech processing for narrow radio channels.
Right.
So anyone who tried to use it, it didn't do that good a job.
Right. I mean, what I keep thinking of is what you said it well. You have octagonal bolts trying to go into into round holes. I mean, I've been intrigued, especially with the Chinese. You know, these Titerra radios have seemed to catch on a little bit with the DMR crowd, and we saw, what was it, the Baofeng UDM5R or whatever. They made a DMR radio that keyed up both time slots and caused a bunch of trouble. What's your take on all that?
Well,
it's not D-Star.
It's not D-Star. And TDMA is an interesting technology, and all of it's related to your other question with Codec 2, and actually that's a poorly chosen name because it's a vocoder rather than a straight codec,
right.
Which is AMBI, and SPX isn't. A codec would do compression by taking bits out, basically. A vocoder is actually analyzing the speech pattern and sending symbols down that represent that speech pattern and the attack and decay and so on of the voice, and consequently it can be reconstructed pretty well at the other end, but it's not a speech compression so much as a symbolic representation of what the speech
now, they're modeling your voice pads.
Right. If you play resonance music through that, it's going to fall apart. Yeah. Because it's not hearing words. A vocoder is actually listening for words. And that's what Codec 2 is doing. So what this all wraps around is, in the general mobile radio market, the push is for narrower and narrower and narrower channels so that you can get more channels into a given bandwidth. And there were two ways to do that. One is to lower the data rate going through the radio, and a compressor can't get you down to where you need to be for, say, a 6.25 kilohertz wide channel, whereas the vocoder can. And so that's why the selection of the vocoder for so many of those protocols. The other option was, and I believe it was Motorola that made this argument, if you want a 6.25 kilohertz channel, if we can put two voice channels on 12.5 kilohertz, we've done the same thing. And they
sort of.
Yeah.
Sort of.
So that's why the two time slots. because then you effectively have two 6.25 kilohertz channels. The reverse of that is physics come into play. And one thing about ham radio operators is they like to DX, right? Including DXing repeaters. And in TDMA, because you have these two time slots going on in the channel, you have this little guard band, and the further and further away you get, the closer those guard bands get together, and eventually the signal falls apart.
Yeah, the repeater is a referee.
Right.
Telling each of the two people that are using the two time slots, your turn to go, your turn to go.
Right.
And the time it takes to get round trip to a mobile radio at 40, 50, 60 miles becomes too much delay.
75 kilometers or something like that, Robin?
Yeah. We don't think of those of the time delay just to reach a mobile 50 miles away from a repeater is significant at all, but in this system it is.
Well, we've done D-Star contacts through satellites. It's probably not something you're going to do on a DMR radio.
Yeah. So would you guys like to see, we're going to redefine the term multi-mode radio. Multi-mode radio used to mean, it does CW, sideband, AM, maybe FM. Now multi-mode radio could mean it does D-Star, C4FM, DMR, P25. That would be a multi-mode radio to me. Would you guys see such a radio? I mean, in theory, there's one down in a building I haven't checked out, the DV4 Mobile. Marty's not paying attention to the show anymore.
I am here.
When I'm talking, you're always on camera now. So see, it's a two-shot.
I am completely here. When you see the chairman was walking, the exhibits chairman was walking about.
Okay.
See if I could.
Okay.
He came in here.
Squirrel.
To see if we could.
Yes. Someone. I don't know if they've announced that the availability of that radio.
I haven't heard anything. Have you?
So
I don't know their schedule.
So I guess my question is,
that's going to happen.
Looking forward to radios like that.
Yeah.
But just like Apple gives you a little more every year rather than giving you 10 more things every year.
Right.
You know, they'll give us another protocol and then maybe two or three years later they'll add one. And then ultimately I think we're going to get to software defined radios that can do any protocol. Problem with those is the processing power to do that takes a lot of battery.
Right.
And so that's the
trade-off
right now.
Some hams have issues with that.
Yeah. The thing about it is all these standards that we're talking about, most of them run on AMBI, maybe different flavors of AMBI, but they do. And once you have a chip like the 3000 in the radio or the software equivalent of it in the radio, you could switch between protocols. But as my friend Brian likes to say, these protocols are 95% the same and 100% incompatible. So what
I thought that was your line.
That's actually Brian's. I steal it from him. Given that, the situation you run into, I have helped enable one of the worst things in the world, and that is to run digital analog and another digital on the same frequency. And so you end up with people that can't hear each other.
Yeah.
But they're going to do it. So
we
I
have
help
a song
them do
for
it.
That.
We do. You want to hear my? I'll give you the first part of my song. I'm not much of a singer. Incompatible. That's what you are. D-Star System Fusion DMR. Now buy three HTs instead of one so that you can talk to everyone. Which mode will it be when you're calling me? Incompatible in every way. Marketing demands, that's how they'll stay. I don't remember the rest. Anyway.
If you thought we were crazy.
Yeah, that's my song. My holy grail, my mantra is the radio that does everything. And this applies
to
the HF radios as well. It'll do every mode, and you tune in a signal, and it looks through its available codecs and says, okay, this is the one I'll tune that in. If it can't understand it, it sends a sample off the internet to a server, which says, oh, here's the codec you need, sends it back to your radio, installs it. Meanwhile, the radio's been buffering the signal, And all this has to happen within about 5 or 6 seconds, and it starts playing back the buffer at maybe 1.5 times until it catches up. So you miss nothing when you tune in a signal. That's my holy grail. How many years away from that are we? Which one of you guys are going to design it?
We've actually thought seriously about that. When you switch into radio and doing RF, and specifically more high-power RF, it requires a lot more engineering resources to do that, and a lot more FCC and CE involvement.
Hoops to jump
get to that. Yeah. So I think John can speak to that because he has some RF products.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we've got one that we've been working on for years, and I won't go into the whole history of that. But once you move into the RF realm, there is a lot of testing and a lot of regulatory, and you know, that radio you described that I think everybody would love to have for $79.95.
Well, right. Yeah, that's the problem.
That's the catch-22.
With satellite internet connect so that you can be out in the wilderness and pull it in. I think we'll see something approaching that in the amateur marketplace, but it's not going to be in the next couple, 3 years.
And it's not going to be $79.95.
That's for sure.
Yes, $7,995.
Yeah. Maybe. Well, and where do they go from there once you have the radio that does everything?
Can you quit the hobby
radio
and go home?
Well, then they started concentrating on software.
Yeah.
You know, it's like the Flex guys say, their radio is a server.
Yeah. And, you know, we do an SDR implementation, a spark gap, you know, so.
So is, I guess, is analog here to stay?
Yes.
It's currently the least common denominator.
I think we'll see all the modes.
And there'll be something
new. ICOM has a really interesting new receiver, the follow-on to their 8500, the 8600, that they're showing here at Hamvention. And it does all the modes. So you can sit there and listen to DMR and D-Star. And
is that's the touchscreen receiver that it looks like a 7300. But
it does.
Yeah, I was playing with that today.
That's a gotta-have-one sort of radio.
It's a very cool radio. It also kind of has, you know, there's a lot of, I'll call them complaints, when the 7300 came out, which is obviously a very different radio for different frequencies, but the boxes are very similar, so I have to compare them. You know, and they have the I's and the I and Q out. You know, they have the 10 meg reference people wanted.
You know, if that radio had a mic jack, it would be one of those.
It would be a killer radio.
That's right.
Well, I have a nice Dremel tool you can borrow.
Yeah.
So what are you telling people is you know, coming down the pike? When you do your forum?
You know, I think we're seeing much more integration of the different modes. Folks over in Europe are doing some very interesting work with creating, you know, chat rooms where you can come in with any protocol and it transcodes to the other protocols. But then you kind of have to decide which protocol are you transcoding. Are you doing one to many so everybody hears their protocol? And it's interesting stuff. So I think that's, we're going to see more of that. But I really still think that D-Star is the best protocol for ham radio right now.
I'd agree with that.
Because it's got call signs. Every time you key up, the other guy sees your call sign. They see your message that you sent out. They can see your location.
The two I think of are D-Star and Fusion. And it seems like, you know, there isn't, I know where I live, there isn't that much Fusion.
Yaesu has had a couple of hiccups.
Yeah.
Some challenges.
With Fusion.
Right.
And it could have been a major competitor to D-Star.
But it isn't.
And it's, I don't think it's going to be.
No.
And it's mainly because of their hiccups.
Yeah.
In pushing it out the door.
And the way their infrastructure is put together, as well as the technological hiccups that they had. They also did an interesting thing with the vocoding, the half-rate vocoder, which is a 4,800-bit stream like D-Star, 3,600 for the vocoding. They used the same ambi parameters that DMR uses, that NXDN uses, that PDMR uses and so on. But for their full rate, they did a hybrid. They didn't pick one that you can just pull out of the table on the 3000 chip, for example. And it sounds wonderful. It really does. But they could have done it with a standard set of parameters and done more enabling that way. And, you know, it's that constant battle between compatibility and innovation, and that's why your perfect radio is actually kind of difficult, because you do want to innovate. And, you know, what Robin talked about of some of these reflectors that are multi-protocol, for many of the protocols, it's simply rip off the headers and the encapsulation and pass the ambi from one channel to the other. The other ones, you have to do some encoding and decoding and transcoding, including analog coming in on analog to those reflectors. So I think one thing that's evolved over the years is we used to be much more provincial. If you were on one system, you didn't want to hear from anybody on the others, particularly those guys on analog. They're just behind the times.
I think that the manufacturers, at least, and to the hams themselves, to some extent, still like to have their armed camps, their walled gardens.
I do Fusion. I do D-Star.
You'll always have that. But I think there's more willingness to accept the idea of a multi-protocol reflector, for example.
Yeah.
And so, you know, things are going to evolve. One of the things that we think about over at Northwest Digital Radio is, once you're in the digital space, it's just bits. Can we deliver a higher capacity of bits on a given radio channel? And once you do that, then it's whether the bits contain D-Star or Fusion.
Yeah, whether they're red bits or blue bits or green bits, it really doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. You just had to deliver them in order and in a reasonable time frame. And so we're thinking a lot about those kinds of things. Where can we get some better efficiencies in that? Now, analog will always be analog, but surprisingly, much of analog also is bits, because we turn it into PCM, we send it over something like All-Star or EchoLink or IRLP. So again, what can we do with the bits? Get them more efficient, get them interleaved.
Some of the repeater controllers actually take it and turn it into bits and move it around and then
send
it
back out. Yeah. So I think that there'll be some interesting work over the next few years about towards your goal, but the idea that maybe there are yet to be discovered protocols that we can do that are more efficient.
Well, there certainly will be.
Yeah. And
no, we have the most efficient.
We're done.
Yeah, well,
technology is done.
Why would we ever need more than five computers in the world? I mean,
yep.
So.
So well, it's more than 64K in a PC.
So they named their biggest computer after him. That was the Watson guy, right?
Yeah.
So speaking of bits, somebody was telling me after a recent program that D-Star is not digital, and it's not 6.25 kilohertz wide. And I did not have the technical chops to respond to that, but you guys do.
Mm-hmm. You want to approach that one, or...?
Well, when you look at it on a spectrum analyzer, you can see the waveform pattern of the GMSK modulation that's used. You can see where the 6.25 is, and the skirts are outside of that, but they're within the six. You can put two repeaters in 12.5 kilohertz, so that meets the 6.5.
Part of it's where you measure what you consider no longer in the modulation mass.
Right.
And I have a guy up where I live that he wants it 100 dB down. You know, an FM signal is infinitely wide. It's just how far down...
Are the skirts.
Yeah. And that 6.25 kilohertz spec is a legitimate specification.
Yeah, it has some shoulders down at minus 40 dB or so.
Right.
That extended out to more like 8 kilohertz, 9 kilohertz.
Yeah.
But those are weak.
And you can detect those two signals side by side. So.
Yeah.
So
and there really is no such thing as digital. So if that's what they were alluding to,
yeah, I don't know what you're
You have to represent ones and zeros with analog values, whether it's volts or RF levels. It's everything is analog.
And everything is digital.
You know, until we get to an electron representing a bit, there's going to be analog.
So,
but if it wobbles, it'll still be analog.
That's once we split it, and
we'll have to see.
That's right.
So let's talk a little bit about D star on HF.
Mm-hmm.
So this has existed for a while, correct?
Yeah, I'm going to say bad idea.
Why?
Tell the bandwidth. Sunday night folks that do that net every week that it's a bad idea.
How
they have a ball.
How many people are... So there's what? How many radios support it?
The ICOMs 9100 the from ICOM and the 7100 from
right.
ICOM.
And Flex Radio has... They plug in the thumb DV and they have a waveform for it. There have been some people that... Jim Mowens had a board plugged in to an HF rig. It's a lot of fun. I actually run the hf.dstar-relay.net website, which is a live chat, and we have push buttons so they can say what band they're on and what frequency and so on.
Yeah.
That thing gets real busy at times.
But the reason that I say bad idea is the bandwidth. 6.25 kilohertz is what we call narrow. Mm-hmm. On VHF, UHF.
And it's crazy wide on 20 meters.
It's not crazy wide. It's
narrower than AM.
It's a little bit, well, it's about the same as AM. And maybe a little wider than AM, the way you theoretically ought to be doing AM. Kilohertz signal. And 2.5 times the sideband signal. So it's spectrum inefficient for what you get back.
Are there any other ham protocols that are spectrum inefficient?
Plenty.
No.
And so it's the thing where I wouldn't say don't do it. I would say don't propagate it across the whole band.
Well, and in fact, the nets they have pretty much stay around watering holes, much like SSTV, right? So SSTV, they hang around one or two frequencies. People that aren't knowledgeable about that come in and step on them with their kilowatt single sideband signal.
Yeah.
The same with the digital HF, but it's really quite glorious to be on an HF band that's full of static and noise and QRN and QRM, and you push that button to DV and it's silent until a voice comes through with beautiful fidelity.
Yeah, and if D-Star were the only way you could do that, I think that would be cool. Mm-hmm. But there is free DV based on codec too.
Exactly. I also
at 1.1 kilohertz or a little more if you want a little bit better fidelity.
Yeah, I also run qso.freedv.org. And it's actually the same code base with just minor tweaks to it.
So I've heard a couple of interesting things, speaking of codec too, from both, now I'm spacing on his name, the guy that wrote codec too.
David.
Yeah, David Rowe. And from Yuli at... Wireless Holdings, the DV4 folks, their radios that they're working on will do on-channel TDMA repeating.
That's
so they use the two time slots, one to receive for a moment and one to transmit it back out. So a repeater with no duplexer. In Yuli was saying that in a 12.5 kilohertz channel space, he can fit 8 voice repeater channels.
In theory, on a codec 2 system, you could do that.
So I don't think he was using codec 2. He said his radio would support codec 2. He hadn't put it in there yet, but it would support it. He's got something proprietary or something that's his own codec. But, I mean, that is a game-changing concept for repeaters if it works.
Well, you could have said the same thing when we went from FM to D-Star. That, you know, it's much narrower. We can get... 3 signals, and when you look at 20 kilohertz spacing for FM repeaters in part of the band, you could fit 3 D-Star signals in it. It really didn't make much of a difference.
Yeah, but it did in a couple of ways. It allowed frequency coordinators who, when D-Star came around, stocked up on extra strength Excedrin, I think. but they did start slotting them in the areas of the country and in the areas of the band where we use 20 kilohertz channels. They stuck them on the in-between 10 kilohertz spot with the necessary geographic spacing to keep the signals weak enough, because that 10 kilohertz wasn't enough of a separation between a D-Star signal and an analog FM signal.
Well, in the area of the country that I'm from, they didn't do that. There was a big fight in the southeast.
In Atlanta?
Over...
You're in Sarah territory, and Sarah does do that.
Sarah didn't want D-Star at all. Sarah initially would not allow you to put up a D-Star repeater, would not coordinate a D-Star repeater. And through efforts of several people, including John Davis, who became a Sarah vice director.
Sarah, we should explain, I guess, Sarah's the Southeast Repeater Association, and they do frequency coordination in... 8 southeastern states, not including Florida and Mississippi.
Right.
No, Florida and Alabama. Mississippi is in there. So a big frequency coordinator. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, I was watching their consternation over D-Star.
We did get some new channels available. They allocated some areas that formerly weren't repeater channels for D-Star. But the big fight was, if I have an FM repeater, can I... convert it to a D-Star repeater. And initially, they did not allow that. Now they do.
Yeah. And up in my area, I actually, like John Davis, got on the board of the local coordination. We did a couple of different things. One was that we never had a question. If you wanted to take your analog system digital, you could do that. But there was greater demand than there were frequencies. 2 meters was the biggest challenge, of course, as it is in most of the country. So what ended up happening is between 146.4 and 146.6, traditionally people use that a lot for simplex operation. But it's in the repeater subband of 2 meters. So we took the bottom half of that spectrum and split it into 8, well, people will check my math. We have a series of 12.5 kilohertz channels in there, and one that is only 6.25. So that allowed different bandwidth digital systems to go in there, and those are mostly filled up now. In fact, that's where my 2 meter D-Star repeater is D-Star/Fusion. It's actually both. And that's worked out pretty well. But different parts of the country had different approaches to it. And
that's where 220 is really exciting.
That 220 is really exciting. You can get an allocation. If we could get Kenwood to do a mobile of their handheld, that'd be...
I really expected to see that this year.
Yeah.
But we didn't.
That they didn't do it.
Yeah. We didn't see anything from Gazoo either.
No.
I've got people lined up with money in their hands that will buy it. I would have laid down my money here if they had had it. So,
all right.
In fact, there's a email address.
Yes. I don't remember it either.
To lobby them to.
It's
to
Saturday
lobby.
Afternoon.
In fact, people internal to Kenwood here are trying to lobby Japan to make the mobile. And they're trying to get as many people as they can to send to this email saying, hey, I'm ready to buy. Here's my money.
This is the time, Bob, that you guys out there in Radio Land get off your duff.
Get on your email.
And cram them.
Email Kenwood at this whatever address. I'll put it down in the link below. I'll have it listed down here.
Answer the questions. Got to answer the questions.
And give them your call sign, your name, your location, and how many you think you'd buy. If you think you'd buy one, hey, there's a good number. If every single one of you guys emailed Kenwood and offered your opinion up on this, I think this show right here could make this happen.
You can put it on the crawler.
You can put it in the crawler when we get
yeah. Well, I was going to ask about your newer products. The original ones were only designed to talk on the reflectors that were part of what they call the U.S. Trust.
Correct.
Which is set up by the guys in Dallas, the first guys putting up D-Star repeaters. And then, and that's really just it's not a network, it's just an organizational scheme, which repeaters can, because D-Star lets you route your signal based on plugging in a call sign in the field. Put in a call sign, make a transmission, tells the repeater where to send the signal on the internet.
Yeah, that used to be the way it was.
It's not that anymore.
I still do that, Robin.
There's call sign routing, which was the original. It's built into the protocol.
Yeah.
But
your systems still work. The DV dongles and the DVAPs, the original ones, were U.S. Trust based. It was a database that says that got sent out to all the repeaters, so that it said when I put AA4RC or REF001 into my your call field in the radio, send my signal down the internet to this specific spot. Well, the U.S. Trust was run by the guys in Dallas. They had some rules. Before your information got entered into it, you had to tow some lines. Not everybody liked towing those lines. So other guys made other databases.
What are these lines you talk of?
Not really qualified to say what they were. Robin can probably say very specifically that they were careful not to break the database because it
really
screwed
things
up.
Everything in ham radio, when you get three hams together, there's two ham clubs.
Yeah.
So inevitably there was going to be a split in protocols, and people that didn't like the U.S. and wanted to do their own thing, or didn't like the EU and wanted to do their own thing, or didn't like the people in the city next to them and wanted to do their own thing.
Yeah.
And that's actually, while it's split people, some very innovative ideas have come out of that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what I'm wondering is, new databases got built. And so they have different names for their servers, and there are some products that work across all of them. What do you do with your newer products? Are you still U.S. Trust only, or do you let folks connect to the X reflectors?
We haven't released the newer products yet.
Okay.
They're about 3 months out. And I just made some changes to the infrastructure that I wrote that no longer is tightly coupled to the trust server on the original network. So it makes it more easy to integrate with other systems as well. And we've actually talked to some of those folks about putting some of the infrastructure I wrote on their repeaters so that it's all compatible. I think even if we did that, there would be a group that said, oh, we don't want to do that, we want to do this. And so there will always be factions doing their own thing, and the users ultimately decide on what they want to do.
Right.
Great.
And you know, the other reflector systems, and I'm sure Robin could confirm this, it's a matter of software. What do we do in the software that the device is attached to determine what it can connect to or direct traffic to? And, you know, one of the requirements of the U.S. Trust system is that you registered your call sign with them. I've always had a problem with that. I got my authorization when the FCC issued me a call sign. But I understand.
But since we're international and we can't verify, and there are countries that require that.
Yeah.
And in fact, in the early days, they stopped the use of D+ in Australia until they verified that the people were registered. Because now you have devices that have no ham radio that are getting into a ham radio network and transmitting on ham radio frequencies.
Right, right. Even though they're
not
using radio.
So some countries require that you be authenticated.
Well, your original DVDongle did that.
Yeah. Right.
You start from a computer and ended up.
Exactly.
Yeah, and so, you know, those, in my perspective, artificial barriers, there are reasons why they were put into place, and Robin gave an illustration of that. There were some jurisdictions that felt that not just knowing the call sign of the person speaking was sufficient. But that all being said, the other systems are there. They're open to people having access to them. It's a question of what software you want to attach to your device. Everything I work on, we try to be as accessible to everything as we can.
Yeah. I will say I've been loyal to your products as opposed to what the real case is. I've been lazy. I understand that there are third-party software that will run on my dongle or my DVAP and talk to those other systems.
Right.
But I've never gone looking.
People that want to talk to those other systems, I openly show them how to get to that software and use it. That's the nice thing about D-Star is it is open. The protocol's open, not only the RF part, but the portion that talks bits on the internet, TCP/IP. And so people that are knowledgeable about writing network code can pick up and do their own thing. And so many people have.
All right. Great. Is there anything you guys been dying to get on the show here that we haven't asked about?
I don't know. We've
got
to
talk about your new little thing.
Well, we actually have something that's only a concept board at the current time. We make a little device called the UDRC, which stands for the Universal Digital Radio Controller, and that's what we use to create the D-Star controller for other repeaters. You can also run packet and FLDG and other data modes through it. And it has two radio connectors on it. You plug it into the radio or the repeater's accessory.
Hold it up toward that camera. Yeah.
I will.
At you.
So what we did is those connectors are on this side of the board on the UDRC. And what we did was we said, well, why don't we just break that off and put a 1-watt transceiver there? And so that's what this is and why it has an SMA connector. Now, we got this from our assembly house just in time to put it in the suitcase and bring it out to Dayton. It's never even been lit up yet. So we have some characterization to do on it. We're going to target this for like a 120 price range. We decided with this product, not because we need the funding, but there's some value to doing a Kickstarter. So we're going to do a Kickstarter on it, and there will be a discount. It'll probably be $100 for these boards on that Kickstarter. Once you see that go up, it'll be about 90 days to delivery on that. But we've a good deal got to characterize exactly what all modes we're going to support in it.
So. Great.
Okay, so a 1-watt transmitter, I mean, does that make a whole radio? Is that what we're talking about?
Yeah, it's a full, half duplex radio. 1 watt.
And it goes on a Raspberry Pi.
And it sits on a Raspberry Pi as a hat.
And then whatever mode you pick, have the Raspberry Pi tell it to operate?
Yep. And the Raspberry Pi also controls frequency and other operating parameters within the radio.
And it's designed for which band?
The modules that we get from the manufacturer, they deliver a 130... 4 to 170 megahertz version and a 400 megahertz version. The chipset will actually also do the 220 band. They don't manufacture one of those, but we're in discussions exactly what they'll do for us. One of the, they're made in China, of course. One of the things about working with the Chinese, if you go to a U.S. manufacturer and you say, I'd like you to modify your product for what I want to do, with it, they say, well, give us your financials for the last 400 years and how much can we extract from you before.
And then they copy it and put it on Banggood the next week.
Right. In China, you go say, we'd like these changes. They say, how many units are you going to buy? That's the only question. How many units are you going to buy and how soon? And then they give you a price for it. So we'll see what falls out with that.
So are your boards made in China?
They're not. The boards for all of my products are made in the Atlanta area. They're assembled in the Atlanta area. There's probably two or three parts that come from China that you can't get away from because that's the only place they're made. But they are American made.
As are ours. I mean, it's the module. It's, again, you buy a component. The component may be made in the U.S. or in Mexico or in China. But our boards are assembled in the U.S.
As well. All right. Sort of the reason I'm asking is, obviously, China stuff is flooding into the U.S. and has been for a long time. we don't hear very much about dealing with them on a manufacturing level, you know, a step deeper or two than the consumer level. So I'm wondering what your experience has been.
Well, in our case, again, we don't do manufacturing there. There's a lot of reasons why you don't do that. There's a lot of reasons why you would. For example, if we do an extruded aluminum case for that has a high heat sink dissipation capability, that might cost us $10 to $60 just for the case with U.S. manufacturing. In China, they'd say, how much does it cost? How much does it weigh? And then they'd multiply that out by their factor, and we'd pay like $1 or $2 a piece for those.
Yeah.
Those are good. But when you get to more sophisticated circuitry, they're happy to substitute parts without telling you, and certain things like that. You know, sometimes your specs are pretty tight, and so you want to have a little better QA on it.
That was the biggest thing for me, is that you can get it cheaper. We looked at manufacturing our products in China, and we could definitely get it a few dollars cheaper, but then all the DOAs, we couldn't send back to China.
Right.
We had to have engineering time to try to figure out what it was or throw the boards away, and in the end, it was going to be more expensive for the quantities that we purchase to do it in China.
And then for us also, in the case that we do need something out of China, we actually have a native speaker that lives in China that can go to the factory and knows how to swear in Mandarin. But as Robin says, you need to have a quality product for your customer. You don't want DOAs, you don't want reworks, that kind of stuff. And U.S. manufacturing, when it just comes to assembly, you can do reasonably. You know, we have fiberglass done in China, and if you have it done in the U.S., it's also done in China.
That's right. Okay. Yeah, you don't buy printed circuit board material anymore from the U.S.
No, even if it's a U.S. company, it's made in China.
Okay, Robin, where do people find you? What's in
website?
Your company name is not bandied about a lot, is it? Internet Labs?
Yeah, we haven't really touted the company. It's been more about the products. Internet Labs is the name of the company, and we initially have the DVDongle.com website and the DVAPDongle.com website.
Which looks like they were built sometime in the late 1980s.
Well, they were built with nice Apple technology. They're very... they still look... They're sparse,
they're
but
simple.
Modern.
Yeah.
Like they're Google's very Apple-like. That was what
like,
I was going for.
Like Google's front page.
Right. And I think that as we grow products, I'm going to have to actually make it a single place to go for all the products rather than a different website. So.
Okay, but the best place to find your new stuff when it comes out, where are you going to put that?
Those will all be announced on all of the Yahoo groups for DVDongle, DVAPDongle. We'll make an announcement to the world for it.
So DVDongle.com is the place to go.
Right.
And you?
So our main company site is NWDigitalRadio.com, and that's where our store is and, you know, about us and stuff like that.
NW because you're in Washington State.
Right.
Well, the name of the company is?
Northwest Digital.
Yeah.
But that gets to be a writer's cramp to put into the browser. We've moved all of our support and documentation to the groups.io platform. You know, put any of our product names in Space Wiki and you'll find the right group, because we make our wikis public so that people have ready access to the documentation. It's a much superior platform as far as I'm concerned. We were on Yahoo Groups for a while, and there's a good community there. There's a lot of interaction. You have a built-in wiki and some other things that are really nice. So.
Okay, so what's the route for that? What's the way in?
Groups.io, and then you look for, I think it's NW-digital-radio. The easiest way is just to go to Google and say thumb DV space wiki, and you'll get to the right group.
All right.
The product you guys started with was a UHF data radio, sort of.
You're not going to let me get away with that?
Brian never really liked it when I called it a data radio, but that's the closest we could come up with that people would understand quickly, which is not on the market yet.
It is not on the market yet.
And Brian is now a little pile of ash?
Brian did have the ceremonial setting on fire. We were inside of a Microsoft building at the time, so they wouldn't actually let him go flambeau, even though we had plenty of fire extinguishers at the ready.
But I asked, what I'm referring to is a promise he made at a DCC 2 years ago, which was if he didn't have it out by Dayton, he would set himself on fire.
Yes.
So still not out.
Yeah.
What's the deal?
It's the fact of the matter is that several of our personnel that are working on that have had various medical or personal life issues. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those things where you call it the monkeys on this engineer's back, and then it goes to this engineer. The problem is if this engineer's out for 6 months and then that engineer's out 6 months, you run into these very long lead times. We are making progress. Right now, the monkey's on one particular engineer's back in the RF space. I won't go into his personal details, but he is spending time on it, so we should see some more progress.
It seems like an interesting product. It's been a long time coming. A lot of people have been waiting for it.
Right.
So it's not, you know, it's not something you've abandoned just because you got shinier, newer toys to play with.
Well, and the fact of the matter is all the shiny new toys are stepping stones for different components that go into the big product, the digital radio. The catalyst of that radio was D-Star also has a data mode, which is Ethernet packets encapsulated inside of D-Star packets. And the only implementation of that was the ID1, which is now off the market.
Yeah. Is it off the market?
Yes.
When was it?
They ran out of inventory last year.
Last year.
They quit manufacturing in like 3 years ago.
But the rumor is they have a replacement for it in the wings.
Well, we'll see. But anyway, the idea was let's build a radio that has that kind of a data capability. One mode would be compatible with the D-Star. We believe that there are more efficient header protocols.
So it will do much, much more than that.
And
this is a whole other show.
And one of the other things was putting it on a band that's a little more approachable for some people.
70 centimeters.
70 centimeters so that we won't go to PL259s, but we can do end connectors. And it's much easier for people to get a cable that isn't too lossy at 70 centimeters.
Yeah. Your data rate is half of what they were doing on 1200, I believe.
So there's a regulatory requirement on 70 centimeters that doesn't exist on 1.2. And you can have a base baud rate of 56 kilobits or 56 kilotransitions is one term, bauds. And that's on a single carrier shifting back and forth. It can't exceed 100 kilohertz in bandwidth. Interestingly, that same spec applies to the 219 ham band. Some people may not be aware, but hams do have a band at 219 megahertz with 10 of those channels. Using more modern modulation techniques where you have multiple symbols per baud, we can probably exceed 100 kilobits per second on that channel.
Yeah.
All right.
A couple things that we're not quite done yet. A couple of things that I'm curious about. You got to go?
No.
Go to the bathroom or something?
No.
I wondered why his knee was wiggling over here.
The first question is...
If I did, I certainly wouldn't say to the camera.
That's the way I started a program down in Orlando. The first question of two is, will the FCC rule proceeding about the baud rate thing affect the UHF stuff as well as HF?
As I recall, it didn't really make a lot of difference in the VHF, UHF space. It was primarily an HF.
Yeah. And why could I operate on 70 centimeters, 6 megahertz wide on a digital signal that's showing my face and not my typing?
So that's an interesting interpretation. The rules were written before stone tablets were cast in concrete. And so it's the fact that it's an image that determines the bandwidth that they permit. The fact that you're using a digital modulation is irrelevant to the bandwidth that they allow in the regulation. The same thing with digital voice on HF. If you called it a digital signal, it would follow under a different set of rules than it's a voice signal that's digitally modulated.
So it's just thoroughly obsolete regulations.
Absolutely.
So my suggestion is you put a little bug in the side with your call sign as an image, because the image mode, the digital image mode, sends stuff besides my face.
Right.
A lot of other metadata is going along with them. Stick a little bug in the side, KN4AQ. Okay, here's my image, and now here's the other payload.
Right.
6 megahertz, here you go.
They do have some regulations on mixed mode as well. So,
yeah, I feel a little larceny coming on.
It really feels like the FCC is backing off of the being strict on regulations and letting amateur radio self-govern a bit.
I mean, we saw that with the, or we're seeing that with the 15 dB rule. I'm talking about linear amplifier gain. And with solid-state devices now, that's becoming more and more inappropriate.
Well, even with D-Star on HF.
Right.
I mean, that's probably not within some of the regs on some of the bands, but it's done anyway.
Right. But nobody's telling you to do it. People are just doing it. But even the ARRL is behind ditching the gain rule now. I mean, I think FCC is going to deregulate this sort of thing. I think it's coming.
Well, we'll see. Agit-Pi. Give them a try. All right, guys, thank you very much. Marty, you want to wrap this up? You're fundraising?
Yeah, I'll fundraise. PhasingLinePodcast, one word, .com. Click the donate button. Scroll down. There's PayPal. There's Patreon. Pay me monthly. Pay me once. We really appreciate the money. This is really expensive to do, and your donations help a lot.
Even though he's using all my equipment, so it's
my time. I had to fly out here.
Yeah, okay.
Right. You need to charge him for the equipment.
Yeah, that's right.
I should rent you my
microphone.
He's
getting money on Patreon, and you should be getting a cut of this.
Yeah. Okay. Well, he makes a lot more on Patreon than I do.
I'll do mine, but I'll tell you, send money to the kid. The kid needs some money right now. AmRadioNow.tv. Hand me Arvin there. Grab him by the leg.
We're wielding this pick around.
Listen to him squeal. AmRadioNow.tv. Find Arvin. Click
the pig.
Starvin Arvin. And Robin Cutshaw. AA4RC, John Hays, K7VE.
Victor Echo.
VE. Do you do any VE testing stuff?
Yeah, I actually picked the call sign because I was part of my motivation to upgrade to extra was to be a full VE.
And you still do that?
I still do. I'm not a real active VE, but a few sessions a year. And also, I was into ATV at the time, so I was also video enhanced.
The danger of picking a call sign based on an activity that you know may change.
Similar pass I did ATV as well in Atlanta. Were the good old days.
Those were the good old days.
I did the ATV show just a couple hours ago with Mike Collins and Mel Witten. So
we got the papers to prove it.
Yeah, they give us the magazine.
The ATQ.
It's all going digital. Yeah. You are Marty Soloway.
KC1CWF.
I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, 73 everybody over.
And
out.
That was a really good show.
This is the point when I stop the cameras when the discussion really gets good.
Are the cameras really off?
No, they're not off yet.